service of Holy Eucharist begins on page 323 in the Book of Common Prayer. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ saith, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us. Glory be to God on high,
and on earth peace to the will towards men. We praise thee, we bless thee, we worship thee, we glorify thee.
Reading from the Acts of the Apostles. When Peter saw the people running together to him and to John, he addressed them, saying, "Men of Israel, the God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant Jesus, whom you delivered up and denied in the presence of Pilate when he had decided to release him. But you denied the Holy and Righteous One and asked for a murderer to be granted to you, and killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses, and now, brethren, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. But what God foretold by the mouth of all the prophets, that his Christ should suffer, he thus fulfilled. Repent, therefore, and turn again, that your sins may be blotted out, that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, that he may send the Christ appointed for you, Jesus, whom heaven must receive until the time of establishing all that God spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets from of old. Moses said, 'The Lord God will raise you up for you a prophet from your brethren as he raised me up. You shall listen to him in whatever he tells you, and it shall be that every soul that does not listen to that prophet shall be destroyed from the people.' And all the prophets who have spoken from Samuel and those who came afterwards also proclaim these days. You are the sons of the prophets, and of the covenant which God gave to your fathers, saying to Abraham, "And in your posterity shall all the families of the earth be blessed." God, having raised up his servant, sent him to you first to bless you in turning every one of you from your wickedness." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. A reading from the first letter of John. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ is a child of God. And everyone who loves the parent loves the child. By this we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and obey his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments are not burdensome. For whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that overcomes the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world but he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ, not with the water only, but with the water and the blood. The word of the Lord.
The doors were shut, But Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. And put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not be faithless, but believe it." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe." Now, Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to thee, O Christ.
From this morning's Gospel, Jesus said to Thomas, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen me and yet believe." In the name of the one true and living God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. You know, as I'm spending my last days as your rector, I've had a chance, whether I like it or not, to reflect on many different things. Some things good, some things maybe not so good. But one of the things I've always been pleased about in this parish is the fact that this parish, for the most part, is full of believers. And believe it or not, that makes a difference. Makes a big difference. Makes a huge difference. In fact, every time I'm asked by another priest, "How do you survive in a downtown church and seem to bob along all right?" And I said, "Well, have you not read your own Bible? I mean, we're graced by God through our faith in God. In fact, we endeavor, as imperfect as we might be, work to be God's people, and it's really work, okay? It's a lot of work. In fact, Christianity and being a Christian is no different than anything else in life that's worth doing. It requires work. Work. One of the things I was musing about, though, as I was thinking about the last nearly 19 years, is back about, I don't know, 13 or 14 years ago, we were visited on this very Sunday, a Sunday typically called Low Sunday, because of a lower attendance. Imagine that right after this. But anyway, we were visited by a mystery worshiper. And there's this website, I don't really ascribe to it too much, but it's called Ship of Fools, okay? Sometimes the church does kind of look like a ship of fools, but anyway, we'll get on beyond that. But they visited this parish. And believe it or not, we got a very high score, okay? In fact, I'll tell you this, we beat by three times any other parish in this area. If it isn't, and let's forget about that too, because who cares? But one of the things that this mystery worshiper said was this parish's commitment to the Anglican tradition, and especially to the Anglo-Catholic tradition, is unwavering. And this person said, and I visited went on to say, and I was preaching that particular Sunday, they said, it's been a long time since we heard priests get into the pulpit and have the guts to say that outside of faith in Jesus Christ, there is no salvation. Okay, well, I'm going to repeat that again today, okay? One of the things that I briefly want to say today is I've always had an affinity for Thomas, and I was ordained to the priesthood on December 21st, which happens to be the feast of St. Thomas. And lo and behold, here I've approached my ordination day only to be sick with pneumonia and bronchitis, and but I had told the bishop, if you have to have me drove up there on a piece of road, I will be there. He said, well, you better. And I remember him telling me, just on a little aside, while we might not get it right in the beginning, he said, and he was talking specifically about Thomas, in the end, if we keep our hearts and our minds open to God, you know what? God will just come on in. Just come right on in. Now, it's going to be a little bit of a woolly relationship sometimes, but you know, that's all right too. That's where we end up growing. And of course, our Lord's sacrifice on the cross, his resurrection, and ultimately his ascension into heaven, is all about bringing about for us God's hard work of salvation. This hard work, I mean, I don't know why we think somehow that our job is supposed to be easy, okay, and always fine. You know, I'll tell you this, I have determined one thing about growing up in the Episcopal Church, because I can say this, I can truly tell somebody when they say, well, why are you an Episcopalian? I can honestly say, because I don't know that. How about that? But I will tell you this, as I have seen American Christianity slide into the ditch, that's another good thing about being toward the end of your tenure, you can say whatever you want to say. Somebody gets mad, and that was a big deal. We have been better at being a social club than we have a church, and that's a serious problem. Serious problem. You know, you all don't realize this, but one of the things that laity, and I'm guilty of this as well, when I was a layperson, we always do better in attendance if we're feeding and drinking. Why is that? And certainly less otherwise. But of course, it brings me to bear on eating and drinking, because you know what? That's what the Eucharist is all about, eating and drinking with God. Just as God did with Jesus. Ultimately, God has provided the sacrifice. And not only has God provided the sacrifice, but he's also provided the benefit. Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. And again, a call to remember. To remember, to go into our history and make that thing present again. Thomas, I think a lot of priests blow this particular gospel. I've heard a number of them do it. Thank God I had a really good New Testament professor whose credentials were unquestionable. He brought this out in this particular passage. How many times have we been in church and heard that Thomas actually touched Jesus? Okay. I don't know where they're getting that from, because it's not there. After Thomas had made those claims, I'm not going to, you know what, you are full of it, I'm not believing, unless I'm actually able to put my hands and my fingers in his wounds. And of course, when Jesus comes into his presence, Jesus offers him the opportunity to do just that. And the scripture tells us nothing about Thomas doing anything other than saying, "My Lord and my God." Now, the reason I brought up the Eucharist in the midst of all of this, being a good little Anglo-Catholic priest, you know, the Eucharist is always right around the corner in any sermon I preach. I can tell you that. But those words that were said by Thomas the Doubter, "My Lord and my God," are the same words said all these many centuries by a traditional priest, as we elevate both the host and the chalice. We're saying, "My Lord and my God." See, the Easter story is all about new life. It's all about being ever more filled with the presence of Christ in both word and sacrament. That hopefully by the end of our lives here on earth, again, by God's grace, we're getting it a little more right than wrong. And not only for our own benefit, but for the benefit also of others. See, we haven't done a lot of thinking over the last many years in the life of the church, much really thinking about God, for sure. I can tell you there are any number of things that have happened in my time as a priest in the church that if we were thinking about God, these things wouldn't happen. But if you keep your faith in the crucified, risen, and ascended Christ, I can tell you that, again, your future will be bright, not because of you, but because of God. And we need to really get that under our belts. See, a parish ultimately is truly measured only by the faith of her members. Because even in a downtown church, I mean, I remember a few years ago, we contemplated, at least in theory, about closing this church down and moving south where we can do better business. And while it was tempting, you know, there's something about the human spirit wanting to do better. We also had to come to terms with the fact that if this church ever ceases to exist, there will never be an Episcopal presence in downtown Fort Price, ever again. Not to mention the fact that we are the oldest continuous church in this community. Well, I'm going to tell you that, again, the reason for this probably has very little to do in some ways with us, but it has a lot to do with God. And if we but have the faith to realize that Jesus is not just an idea. Jesus is not just some kind of concept. But Jesus is the very essence, meaning, and embodiment of life itself. A life that we pray this is just a part of. But as I have reminded you a zillion times, we have to get through this life first. This life means for something. Even though we respect the dignity of human life not very well in this country, unless it's politically expedient, then we seem to all of a sudden be quite moral. The reality is, we need to all, again, live into our faith more fully and more nearly and dearly. Because this world is ultimately going to take everything from us, even our earthly life. We should be giving thanks to a God who is willing to give us new life today, if we but have faith and believe. Of course, when that happens, death is no more to us than a door and a ladder to heaven. See, ultimately, remember what the scripture tells us. Ultimately, it is God's truth that sets us free. May we, during this Easter season and beyond, endeavor to live more nearly and dearly into God's truth. Because you see, there's a blessing given to us. Have you believed because you have seen? But most of us, I don't think, have physically seen Jesus. But here comes the punchline. Blessed, set apart, holy are those who have not seen and yet believe. May we truly be accounted in that number.
Let us stand and reaffirm our faith in the words of our creed on page 327. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth.
pray for the whole state of Christ Church and the world. Almighty and ever-living God, who in thy holy word has taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, receive these our prayers which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, that they may, both by their life and doctrine, set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. We beseech thee also so to rule the hearts of those who bear the authority of government in this and every land, that they may be led to wise decisions and right actions for the welfare and peace of the world. Open, O Lord, the eyes of all people to behold thy gracious hand in all thy works, that rejoicing in thy whole creation, they may honor thee with their substance and be faithful stewards of thy bounty. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. We also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, beseeching thee to grant them continual growth in thy love and service, and grant us grace so to follow the good examples of all thy saints, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant these our prayers, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate.
Amen.
Let us humbly confess our sins unto Almighty God. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of thy Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in thy will and walk in thy ways, to the glory of thy name. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who with great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who have already committed to true faith, turn up to him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always.
And with thy spirit.
Bring offerings and come into his courts. He gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
Thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our righteousness.
God, for the people. God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you. Feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee, for thou dost feed us in these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and thus assure us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are very members and corporate in the mystical body of thy Son, the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of the everlasting kingdom. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in, through Jesus Christ.
Virus is still spreading in this community.
Anyway, happy Easter again. And again, if you're looking for a church home, we certainly invite you to make St. Luke's Parish your new church home. Please stand for the Easter dismissal.
Go in peace, rejoicing, God's Holy Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thank you, God.